Thank you, Subhashini ma'am, yet again for giving me this wonderful opportunity to interact with all of you here today. You know, it feels awesome to come back to academia to share whatever little knowledge that we have gained in the field, working with different customers and different people across time and time. And you know, as we all say, you know, we only need to keep giving back to the academia, and then you know, we also take from it, and then we understand a lot of stuff going forward, and then you know, knowledge sharing becomes the essence of entire thing. And you know, it is my humble attempt in doing that. The topic for today, the topic which I was allowed to choose by myself, was this interesting topic called Zero Trust Security Model. Quite a lot of people would have come across this new term, new jargon, whatever you want to call it, in this world of cybersecurity. And what is this zero trust? What are the myths around it? What are the predicaments around it? What is really it? And you know, let's cut through the jargon and all that, and let's get into that. Now, just before I get into that, I think it's only fair that I give you a very realistic picture of what really I do within Hexaware. It's not a long biography. I know that, you know, Subhashini ma'am has already shared it. So I currently lead the pre-sales solutioning and sizing for Hexaware. I'm based out of Chennai, and I lead a team of consultants who are across India. And we serve global customers cutting across all industry verticals and geographies. So I currently have about 18 years of experience, and with Hexaware, I've been associated for the last 1+ years. Right, without much further ado, let's get started. So this is the way that I have constructed today's presentation. What really is Zero Trust? Why is it important? What is the background about it? What really is this Zero Trust, and how is it that you actually create this particular architecture, blah, blah, blah. What are the benefits of this? How is it that you would apply these conditions? And, you know, we talk about a demo and all that. Not too sure if I'll be able to do a demo, but I definitely can throw examples and all that every now and then. Now, this concept, I might repeat it during the course of my presentation quite a few times. But it is just to prove the point that, you know, how is it different from anything else which we have seen so far, and what really it is and why it is important. So this is the agenda. So let's get into the first section, which is background. What really made all this thing about Zero Trust, and where we are, how is it all of this got started? That's the very first section which we're going to be talking around in background. Right. I'm sure all of us have been around with IT and computer science ever since the early 90s, 80s, and all that. But there's a new word of security and cybersecurity. Cybersecurity is a much later coined word. But if you look at the security trends over time, early 90s was the first time we actually heard of this term called viruses. And they said, you know, this virus is pretty much like the virus of influenza or cold or something of that sort, and it actually spreads across multiple computers across the network. Back in those days, we had floppy disks, and you know, you had to ensure that these floppy disks are scanned and didn't really have viruses in it before it was put into another computer and things like that. Many people actually questioned whether such stuff was really real. And then slowly, you know, the world of BSNL, where, you know, you had internet, which actually came in and all that. Now, war dialing was not something which was very prevalent within India per se, but across in the Western world of Europe and USA, many of these companies, you know, when you had to connect to those companies, just like how we used to have this dial-up internet connection, we could dial up to the companies and then access corporate resources. And there was this concept called war dialing. This was very prevalent at that point in time, wherein a rogue a person who's not supposed to be accessing that particular company's network. You know, they would continuously try and access that particular number, and eventually in one of the combinations they get through, and then, you know, that was a big security challenge at that point in time. Late 90s, we brought in this concept called deep packet inspection. Deep packet inspection itself is a huge ocean by itself. But how is it that we actually inspect whatever is encrypted, whatever encryption happens? How is it that, you know, without doing anything, how is it that you actually look at what is inside the packet when there are encrypted traffics flowing through your network? That was a trend. That was another issue back then in the late 90s. Fast forward to early 2000s, we started hearing about certificates and public key infrastructure. We heard this term called public certificate, private certificates, and this was the time India was also pretty much opening. And then, you know, you slowly started talking about digital signatures, where you had USB tokens and all that stuff. This happened somewhere in the early 2000s, mid-2000s, and things like that. Around the same time, somewhere in the mid-2000s, we actually started looking at things around cloud computing. This is where Gmail actually started. Gmail is a SaaS product, as you all are aware. And slowly, every other company, Amazon, started up with Amazon Web Services, which is a cloud where it, they said that, hey, you don't need to own a data center. You can actually put things on our network and you know, you can consume it in an OpEx model. Quite new, quite path-breaking at that point in time. So from there, you know, we brought in this new term called deperimeterization. This is a jargon, which is something not many of us have heard of. But what it really means is that so far, organizations which were so used to having everything under a perimeter, under their own fortress, so to speak, now they had to realize that there were corporate assets, there were organizational information assets which could reside outside the perimeter. And that's what we mean by deperimeterization. And hence, security now not only needs to look at this, it also needs to look at something which is outside the network as well. Late 2000s, and probably even until as late as 2015-16, we've been hearing this term about NGFW, which is next generation firewalls. A next generation firewall is something, you know, which not only does layer 3, they also said it could do layer 7 inspection, deep packet inspection, that this. Every other company out there, they started having these different coin terms called their next generation firewall was a lot better than the others and things like that. Now let's getting into the next decade of 2010. We now started to realize this new concept called defense in depth, which was primarily designed to stop advanced persistent threats or APTs. Defense in depth, we talked about having multiple layers of security. So if there's a firewall, behind the firewall, you had segmentation, then you had an IDS device, and then you had endpoint security devices, and then you had to ensure there was multi-factor authentication and all those different things. They started building up. So just to ensure that any attack is actually thwarted at multiple layers. This is the whole concept of defense in depth. No, 2010s, from there, somewhere around 2015 onwards, we've been hearing this whole buzzword, which is still happening and still current, which is around the world of AI and big data. Now, we heard, particularly in the world of security, now we know that there are bots which are used by attackers, which are used by hackers, and how is these bots can automatically take up payloads, and they can automatically do distributed denial of service. And hackers themselves have their own databases of large data. And how is it that they're using big data to actually go ahead and target opponents? And how is it that they are attacking? I'm sure you would have all followed such kind of stuff in the recent Ukraine-Russia war. In the Ukraine-Russia war, apart from the physical warfare which is actually happening, there's a lot, there are, you know, cyber warfare, particularly because of the Ukraine-Russia war, is multifold. It's multifold. I mean, we can really go into a different tangent and a different lecture altogether just to talk about how, what are the different attacks which are currently being carried on using AI and big data, both from Europe's side and Russia's side and across the world, and how is the importance for thwarting such attacks, and how is the importance for keeping an organization safe, again leveraging big data and AI, is another lecture altogether. So let's not get into that. And now we are talking of zero trust, and how does zero trust really fit into all of this? And that's what we really are going to be talking about in this particular lecture. So, as I did mention, there are so many vendors out there who currently say that, you know, they do zero trust. If you do a Google search for the word zero trust or zero trust security, there are literally thousands and thousands of products and vendors out there, starting with Microsoft, Google, Zscaler, Palo Alto, Cisco, and a few names which you would have never even heard of for the very first time. And then, you know, there are quite a lot of companies which are now saying that, you know, now my product has got the capability of zero trust. I had this old product, and this new version of this product now has this version of zero trust. So what the heck is zero trust? I mean, is it just this marketing jump bandwagon? Is it, is it just everybody going on an overdrive saying that, you know, zero trust is the next thing? And what really is the hype? What is it that we are trying to achieve by this? Well, if you go and talk to any two different vendors, so for example, if I go to vendor A and then you go to vendor B and you ask them for the definition of zero trust, unfortunately, no two people would actually agree that this is the actual version of zero trust. And hence, it is more important to know the background and chronology before we actually understand what really is the zero trust. But I think I did mention this. Quite a lot of vendors out there. This is just a small list, which actually says that, you know, they currently have zero trust. Yeah. Just a small comic. I just love you to have a look at it. So quite a lot of organizations worldwide are now implementing zero trust. This is a small comic. So what does zero trust mean? Does that mean that I don't believe a person? Is that the whole point, as this comic actually leads you to believe? Not really, not on the point. It's not the way that it is. Let's get into how businesses were designed and, you know, a little more deep dive into the background and history in this particular scenario. Now, we talked of different eras of computing, right? Now, if you look at this particular style, you know, whatever was on the perimeter, the email, the office applications, the back office, the remote gateways, the demilitarized zones, the web servers, any gateway servers or firewalls which used to actually establish VPN connectivity with employees or partner gateways, all these things were the only things which were actually exposed to the outside world. And then in the internal world, we had photocopiers, we had access points, we had wired desktops, corporate laptops, which were issued by the company. And then we used to have these corporate mobile devices, BlackBerries and so on, which were issued to employees to use. Now, the security standard in these cases, as I did mention earlier, was more like a castle. And these castles of security, they were surrounded by moats to ensure any intruders could not actually swim through the moat and get into the castle. This is how yesterday's business was designed. Everything was being controlled. everything could be was under the purview of the IT or the IT security organization. They could know who could print, who could copy. You had photocopiers and printers, which were completely under the control. They ensured that only corporate devices could connect to the internal wireless networks. Only these devices could connect to the wired desktops. And you know, you could not really bring your personal laptop to work or anything of that sort, or your personal mobile. You could not have it to check your corporate emails and things like that. Everything was managed and everything was physically within one or two locations. And hence the analogy of castle and moat. Right. So from there, we actually move on to how today's businesses, right? Fast forward to today. Today, many, many organizations, many, many enterprises, many, many businesses, educational institutions, they've all embraced newer ways of working. We have embraced cloud, particularly in the form of SaaS, IaaS, and PaaS. Almost every organization there, let it be a business, let it be a university, let it be a hospital, let it be even government, are now, have already shifted their email systems to Google or Microsoft Office 365 or Google Suite, or on the process of shifting their solution from on-premise to these SaaS solutions. There are Office applications which are now completely built on cloud. Storage and backup, today we talk of OneDrive, WeTransfer, Google Drive, all those different things. This is where we talk of backup. This is where we talk of storage. And again, we have web servers, we use DevOps, we use containers and Kubernetes to orchestrate all things. We're talking of microservices and all these different things. And then there is also legacy, which is still running inside corporate data centers, right? Like the ERP system. I'm not saying that SAP is a legacy thing, but there are quite a lot of organizations which still choose to keep their ERP on-premise rather than on the cloud. There is legacy identity and access management. There are still VPN gateways, firewalls, firewall management. All this is also happening. So there is a cloud, there is a physical data center, and within the organizations today, where we only used to have Windows PCs, now we have Windows tablets, we have MacBooks, we have iPhones, iPads, Chromebooks, Linux books, we have Android phones. Organizations no longer provide smartphones to their employees. They say, you can bring your own device, you can bring your own phone, and you can actually use it. Across the world, quite a lot of organizations are also doing away with the concept of actually bringing, issuing laptops to their employees. They are allowing employees to take their own, bring in their own laptops. Even back home in India, we are seeing organizations are allowing other third parties to bring in their laptops and things like that and connect to the to their corporate network. And hence, security in the traditional form, wherein you had firewalls and the perimeter devices, they really are not doing the job. But unfortunately, many organizations today still are trusting security to the way that there is. So you go and ask most of the organizations today on what really is their security, how is it that they are keeping themselves secure? Standard answer, they have a firewall and they have antivirus which is installed on all their computers. Some organizations and some people may tell you a little more. They may say that we have network access control and things like that. But all these are really, you know, applying Band-Aid to a severely injured wound rather than actually you going and completely rehashing and redesigning the entire security itself. How is tomorrow's business or tomorrow's organizations going to be? We talk of Internet of Things. Internet of Things is where there is machine-to-machine communication which is going to happen. And we really don't know what really is going to transcribe in that. Wireless is going to become more faster. We are talking of Wi-Fi 6. We are also talking of 5G mobile internet connectivity, right? Now, with IoT, 5G, and Wi-Fi 6, some of this we already have seen practical applications in our normal life. Today, we even within our residences, we have smart bulbs, smart air conditioners. All our mobile phones have multiple sensors. All of us, most of us wear a smartwatch, which is nothing but an Internet of Things, because it can independently talk to the internet. It can take data from your body using biometrics, some form of the other, and it can actually store things. So there are multiple things. How do you ensure that security is actually key to all these newer things which are there? And for this, the answer lies partially on zero trust. We'll talk about zero trust and what really, how zero trust is going to address all of these concerns in just a bit. But before that, right, I just want to show you this particular analyst graph. Historically, we have seen that, you know, it was the network security which was predominant. If you recollect way back in the early 90s and 2000s, and we even up to 2012 or 15 in countries like India, network security was really, really considered as the, you know, most important piece of security. And that started to really go down. And then this new term called endpoint security or host security was taking more and more importance as virus attacks on particular machines started to come in. And that went up on a curve, and now that is also, you know, slight up dwindling. Way back then, we never really talked about data security or information security. And today, it is all about information. And this is constantly seeing an upward rise. So today, data security and information security is more important than what it was in the past, because it supersedes endpoint security, network security, and any other form of security that there is. So with this context, let's now talk about what is not zero trust. And then probably also talk about if that is not zero trust, what really is zero trust? Right. So what is not zero trust? I don't trust you. Is that zero trust? No, that's not zero trust. So if that is not zero trust, is it another device like I showed earlier? Is it a next generation firewall with the now added zero trust? No, that's not it. It's definitely not anything to do with organizations trying to have their VPNs or any other off-the-shelf product. And more importantly, zero trust is not something which is only driven by IT, and it is not a one-time project. It's not that I buy something, I put it, I deploy it, and that's it. I now have zero trust. It's not like that. And it's definitely not eliminating intranet, corporate intranets, though it has got the potential to do that, but that's not really intranet. The reason I had to bring this particular slide was whenever you do go to YouTube or do your own research or talk to any particular vendor, you may receive these different flavors which they would want to taint zero trust with. And I want to really ensure that we are clear that these really are not zero trust. So what really is zero trust? What it should be rather, it's a business enabler. Let's be very clear. Unlike many other security products, whenever IT security comes in, most of the users, they are like, hey guys, this is the age of digital collaboration and you guys in security are not allowing us to collaborate, and hence our productivity and our companies and our company's revenue streams tend to go down. That's a common thing which we hear from many users across the globe. That's not the case. It's actually a state of mind, and where really it's a collaboration between security, It actually, as I did mention earlier, it's a combination of both internet and intranet, and it's a combination of people, processes, and technology aimed at reducing the complexity of security the way that it is. And it definitely is to ensure that there is a unified experience, to ensure there is absolute flexibility and increased productivity for everybody, every stakeholder who's concerned. So what is Zero Trust? I know I'm talking to academia, and I thought, you know, I should probably have a definition, a proper definition. And hence I brought in this particular slide. As you know, Forrester Research is a very well-known research organization. And this actually, this particular term, I also read it for the first time, that actually that, you know, the Forrester is the company which actually, this organization is where they coined this word called Zero Trust. It's actually a complete architectural change for IT security. The businesses, you know, I'm not going to read through the definition, but it is the most effective form of security in this new age world. Because conventional security models, they're not really doing the job, and we saw why. In a nutshell, Zero Trust has got this concept of never trust and always verify. I'm going to talk about and touch about a few examples in my forthcoming slides. But the underlying principle is never trust and always verify. Right. So I think I did talk about this in some of my earlier slides. In the earlier world, the traditional IT server was based on the castle and moat concept, wherein I just have this, and whatever comes beyond the moat and beyond the castle wall is supposed to be good traffic. I trust whatever is inside my castle. This was our approach. So I trusted it. What was the trust here? I ensure that whatever is able to cross the castle and the moat, and by way of firewalls and by way of end-to-end security and whatever it is, that is all trusted. And hence, everything is taken care of. That's not the primary thing when it comes to Zero Trust. Let's talk of a few examples. Do I trust my corporate network? Do I trust whatever devices that are on my LAN network? In the earlier days, whatever traffic was coming from my intranet or LAN could be trusted, because there everything was controlled, everything was issued, and things like that. Right? In this new age, I can no longer blindly trust my corporate LAN. Today, there's an employee with a badge walking into my office. Do I really know if that guy is an employee, or is he probably, you know, this guy was terminated a couple of days ago, but then he's still not surrendered his badge, and then he's trying to connect his laptop to the corporate network, trying to steal data. This is a case of espionage. This was something which was possible in the earlier world. With this new parlance of Zero Trust, I really don't trust anything. I always verify and then trust something before I'm going to do it. We are also going to see how is it that we are going to do all this. There are different tools, different solutions, which all need to be stitched together to achieve Zero Trust. We'll come to that in just a minute. So, in the traditional model, as I did mention another slide, there is a trusted zone, there is an untrusted zone. Trusted zone was anything inside my perimeter. Untrusted zone was everything outside my perimeter, which are people connecting from the internet or whatever it is, right? So I have talked about this in my earlier slides as well. Perimeter-based networks, they operate on the assumption that all systems in the networks can be trusted. They do not accommodate work styles such as bring your own device or bring your own cloud. That's a new term, right? Wherein I come with my mobile phone, I come with my smartwatch, I come with my iPad, and I subscribe to iCloud to do some of my stuff and things like that. In the traditional world, all that is not possible. And I also, as an organization, if I'm going to embrace these new styles of working, I need to ensure that even those extended environments are also secure, because an attacker could really compromise any of these places, and then from there, you could actually come in. Let's talk about this work from home scenario, which we all got used to ever since COVID struck. In many millennial couples, where the husband and the wife, both of them were working for two different organizations, probably two different IT organizations. Now they were sharing a common broadband at home, and from there they were actually connecting to their corporate networks, trying to take whatever information. In the traditional world, had there been, I as an attacker need to only infiltrate into the home networks, because at home there is really not much of security which we give so much of importance. I mean, if I come to your place and I ask you, can I have your Wi-Fi password? You wouldn't even think twice to share your Wi-Fi password. And by logging into your Wi-Fi, I could set up something to just sniff around whatever packets that they're coming in. And from there, voila, I could enter into any of these corporate networks. This was something which was possible in the old world, right? So this is more important, why we should have this concept of zero trust, and how is it that we secure such kind of things as well. This is another use case. Some statistics. There are 4% of users, you send them a phishing email or anything of the sort, they would click on anything. 28% of every possible breach which is out there, attack which is out there, they always involved somebody from the inside. It was always an inside job. And 17% of breaches and all that had, you know, happened just because there was nobody really knew. This particular statistics is quite dated. This is actually from 2018. Unfortunately, I couldn't get a newer slide, but this particular statistic has only evolved. If you look at 2021 or 2022, these numbers have now gone about fourfold or more than that. So, how is it that we ensure, what is it that we are trying to save? I did mention that data takes absolute precedence over a network or endpoint and all that stuff, right? We also talked about this new age trends about artificial intelligence and machine learning. How is it that it is there? And we talked of all these things, all these different places where data can really reside. Data can reside on servers or virtual machines or workloads or storage, right? It can reside within people on their personal devices on and all that. And it can also reside in people's minds. And I cannot trust anything blindly, let it be people, let it be workloads or devices. I need to use some kind of intelligence, some kind of conditions to validate all these different things whenever we are trying to access data, right? And that's the fundamental concept of zero trust. So one of the most easiest things, or one of the most, the first elementary thing that most people will need to do as far as zero trust is concerned, is to ensure that there is a concept of giving least privileged access to enforce access control to users. Let me give you an example. Many of us on our personal laptops are, not on our personal laptops, on our organization provided laptops, we can only do a certain things. We will not be able to view certain websites because they will be blocked. We will not be able to install anything on our computer because we don't have admin access. Now, there still are organizations which would give administrative access to a few users, and let's call them IT administrators. these IT administrators, the only way that they access it is via a password. Now, tomorrow, if this particular IT administrator turns rogue, then using his password, or let's assume I as a user, I'm a friend of the IT administrator. This happens all the time, right? I get his password. And whenever I want something, I automatically enter that password and I do whatever I want to do. I can browse any website. I can install anything. Let's take this example a little farther. Let's assume genuinely I alone in my entire team of 20 people, I need to carry out something on my SAP server every week. I need to do a batch file to ensure I need to run a report. And this can only be done on an administrative access. So what happens? There is an administrative access which has been given to me. And I am supposed to be used to doing only what I am, which is that I need to take that report. But does it restrict me from doing only that? No. What if my username and password are stolen? What if I try to access this particular resource from my personal laptop? There are so many use cases, right? And what if I decide to turn rogue myself? Or somebody else who knows my username and password, they want to steal data, they will be able to go in, forget steal data, they can even sabotage that server if they have administrative access. How do you restrict this? So the concept of least privileges is there. There is this concept of privileged identity management. It's a separate solution which is out there, which says that you only need to give everybody standard privileges. If you use this concept of privileged identity management, PIM tools, it means that only at that appointed hour, let's assume I need to run this report at 7 p.m. on Friday. At 7 p.m. Friday alone, my privilege will get escalated as a user. And I will not be given a password. But when I log in, there will be a multi-factor authentication which will come, and that token will come to my phone or something of that sort. Or it could be a combination of biometric or something of that sort, just to ensure it is actually me who is trying to log in. And this particular admin, I will click on it. There is no password. I click on it. I get inside. And then I'm able to do whatever I'm supposed to do. If I do something which I am not supposed to do, if I overstep, this entire section is recorded. There is AI, machine learning, or there is an administrator who can look into that particular session to pinpoint this user was supposed to be doing only this, but he has gone ahead and done something else. Hence, it is you are able to pinpoint on something that you know that something like this has happened. If I try to log in, let's assume there are organizational conditions which say that this particular report should only be run from my corporate network using only corporate device. When I take my corporate device outside, let's assume I'm traveling, from there when I try it, then you know it should have one another layer of security added. Maybe apart from biometric, there also need to be a one-time PIN, something of that sort, or it should not be allowed, something of that sort. You can design these securities like this. So identity becomes the new perimeter. I'm sure we would have heard of these terms called identity becomes the new perimeter, but this is what it really means. This is one of the use cases for Zero Trust. So if you look at this particular example, which I gave you, we are not trusting the employee blindly. Yes, we will trust him, but only if he is able to validate that he is indeed the user and he is doing whatever he is supposed to do. That is how we verify the user, we validate that particular device, and we only limit him to that particular server at that point in time, because after that he will not be able to log in or anything of that sort, and things like that. And everything is inspected and it is logged so that, you know, tomorrow if something happens, you're able to do it. This is, you know, these things can also be integrated with things like social media, right? Today, organizational handles are there, right? Today, my organization, Hexaware, has got a huge presence on social media, LinkedIn, Twitter, you name it. There are multiple people who are constantly looking at the social media. There is a social media team which constantly keeps posting things into that. Now, we all know that on social media for one particular account, there is only one username and password. And let's assume I have five different people who actually log in and they keep posting things. One of them goes rogue. They can actually cause immense damage to the organization just by posting something which they are not supposed to be posting on social media, right? Today, there is a way, and if there are shared passwords, then there is no way that you can actually find out, tie it down to that particular individual or anything of that sort. Today, there is a way wherein you can even have least privileges for this, just to ensure that only these people at this point in time can have access only to this and all that, using this privileged access management. If we have all this, then we won't, a lot of these embarrassments which celebrities now say that, that post was not put by me, it was actually done by my admin and all that, all those things can be eliminated. Right. So what is the approach for zero trust? They did mention all the resources, they try and access every other data, irrespective of their location. They will access it using a secure manner, meaning all traffic will be encrypted. I already talked about this concept of least privilege. There is no admin user. There is no standard user who has got the global administrative privilege to do everything. No. He may be the IT security person. He may be the IT admin guy, but he can escalate his privilege only for selective tasks, only when he's supposed to be doing it and not anywhere else. And all his requests get logged. All his requests are approved if needed. Now we can design it however the organization wants. And the third principle, the third guiding principle, which I always told you, is you will always verify and never trust anything. Every traffic which is getting inside the organization, be it machine to machine, container to container, all of that is logged and all of that is verified however it is needed. And there is no separate architecture. There is no two zones saying this is trusted zone and untrusted zone, internal versus external. Everything is accessible everywhere, because now I also will have my entire organizational build on cloud, which means that there is nothing which is supposed to be which I host inside. So there is no inside technically. But however, if I have these concepts of least privilege and having all these conditional access and rules to ensure this data can only be viewed by these set of people, they could be employees, contractors, partners, whatever it is, and this data is become public, there are solutions in which you can do this. Another very important solution to do all this is this concept called data loss prevention, DLP, which is also gaining traction over the years, wherein every data which is generated in whichever way by computers, by reports, by AI big data, by users, every data is classified as internal, external or public, confidential, and all that. If there is a mail which is tagged as confidential, you will not be able to print it. You will not be able to copy it. You will not be able to do anything apart from probably writing it down or taking your phone and taking a photograph. Technology is not advanced to that level yet, but there are other physical compensating controls which can be designed to actually address all of these things as well. We also talked about bring your own device, right? Today, with every organization is allowing users to bring their own devices, mobile phones, laptops, and all that. There are mobile device management solutions which every organization can leverage, just to ensure that even within that particular device, they do a sanity check, whether there are any rogue applications installed and all that. And then within the device, they have a container for themselves, an additional security for all their corporate apps like mail, like their chat application, their storage application, et cetera, et cetera. And they only run within a allocated dedicated memory space within that particular machine, so that this particular instance within the mobile phone or anything of that sort, it does not actually integrate, talk with the memory which is used by the other applications like Facebook, Twitter, and all that, which are outside this particular container, so to speak. So if the mobile is lost, or if there is anything which happens on this mobile, which is, you know, like routing or something of that sort, then the security which is built around this automatically will find out that, you know, there is something wrong with the host operating system, and it will automatically lock itself just to ensure that, you know, all data remains secure. Again, zero trust, right? So I talked of multiple things. I've talked about encryption. I've talked about least privilege access. I've talked about identity and access management. I've talked about how we should inspect all the traffic and all that. I've talked about mobile device management and how the network design is from inside out, all that. All of this collectively is part of zero trust. As I did mention earlier, zero trust is not just a single product. It is a combination of people, process, and technology. And this is the approach. So a further, much more detailed slide, as I did mention, there are identity providers who will keep track of users and user-related information. Who are identity providers? It could be your organization's Active Directory. It could be something like your Gmail username and password, right? And tomorrow there could be organizations which are there, which could say, I will just track users based on their Google accounts. So Google has a directory services, and you know, they actually can authenticate users based on that. Not just users, we are also talking of multiple devices which also are now part of the directory, and they provide services and they also consume services. We talked about it, right? And there are policies which should be designed to say if a user or a device conforms to this particular policy. I've given you multiple use cases. Again, let's talk about it. Do I trust the user just by him entering a username and password to ensure that he is actually the person who he claims to be? How do I validate that? Can I bring in another form of validation? Can I have one more form of validation? Can it be biometric? Can it be a one-time PIN, a multi-factor, this thing? So this is basically the concept of multi-factor authentication. How do I ensure that any device which actually confirms which connects to my corporate network or my corporate infrastructure confirms to the standard that it has got all the latest security patches, whether it is running the latest antivirus and things like that? So you have policies and tools to actually ensure that these are all automatically checked and it is sanitized before they actually connect to the network. How do I ensure that whatever accesses that there are, they are actually proxied and they are monitored before they are given allow or deny access to any particular organizational resource? Like, so far everything was fine, but suddenly there was a Russia-Ukraine war which has happened, and now we need to have systems dynamically to ensure that whenever there is a user who is going to try and access my corporate access, corporate internet, corporate information assets from Russia, it should automatically be denied, right? Because we don't know whether it is allowed or not. Or maybe if the organization also has interests in Russia, then they could probably say, we can allow it, but we cannot allow all of this. They can only view it for 5 minutes, or they can only they cannot be printed, or something of that sort. There are multiple things which an organization can decide, right? And so far, till yesterday, while I was able to access all this, today I may not be allowed to do all this because of the risk which I may possess to the organization. And this happens in a more real-time basis. And anomaly detection and machine learning is key to all of this. So we talked about trusted, non-trusted zone. Now we have devices and users on the left-hand side, and then there is the center component called trust. Trust is now determined by the identity provider, the device directory, the access proxy, and the overall evaluation machine learning services, which all collectively form this security, let's call it, for lack of a better word, security cloud, right? Mm-hmm. And anything which is trying to access an organizational resource, it actually goes through all of this, and it is validated and then checked every time before it can access an organizational resource. And this is the new security. Some of this stuff I've already covered. I know I'm actually running out of time. I'm about 55 minutes. I also want to have a question and answer session. So I'm just going to probably fast forward just a bit, just to show, you know, I think I told you, who are your users? What are they trying to do? Why are they doing it that way? What is conditional access? We talked about conditional access, wherein a particular user has access to a particular machine with some special privileges only for a particular time, only for a particular duration to do that particular activity alone and nothing else. And what are the types of controls which we design around that? Another, some of these questions are something which should be considered as far as a policy-based approach or a conditional access and all that. We talked about device health, its compliance state, the user role, group membership, the physical location, what time did he sign in. A user may generally be signing in only during the day, but suddenly he signs up, signs into the corporate network at 1 a.m. at midnight. And then, you know, that should automatically trigger an anomaly to find out why is it that happened, because that's not general user behavior, right? So is that something because this particular user's account was compromised and all that stuff? We see these examples with credit cards right now, right? Credit cards and debit cards. Suddenly, you know, I've received calls in the middle of the night from my credit card company saying there has been a transaction which from an unknown location, is it really you who's actually trying to do it, right? These are all types of risks which we have coming across. Right, I think I did talk about all this. We need to allow across SaaS application, non-premise applications, and PaaS applications, allow and block access, limited access, multi-factor authentication, force people to constantly change their passwords whenever we do suspect that there could have something which is not supposed to be happening. Have controlled session access, allow them only read-only access, but not able to download, print, etc. I think device health, I think I talked about all this. You can actually check whether they have the right drivers, kernels, is it the right frame, firmware, is it not rooted, and all that stuff can be done. Right. I will also share this presentation with everybody so that, you know, you can all probably run through it. And if there are questions, you could come up to me anytime. But I know we are almost on time and I really would love to take questions. And if there are questions, I'd love to answer them right now.
Hello, sir. Sir, myself. Hi. Alka Upadhyay. Sir, I have one question. Suppose, mm-hmm. sir, we talk about geofencing. I want to stop the person if they are trying to access my device or anything from Russia. Sir, mm-hmm. is it possible? Is technology has developed so far for hackers? Can they mask it? Suppose the person is sitting in Russia, but can they change their location as if to me, they will appear as if they are accessing the device from India. Is it possible, sir? No.
Very, very possible. This technology has been there around for a very, very long time. All I need to do is from Russia, I will need to have a VPN connectivity to a server in India. And from India, you know, I try to access that particular website. It's as simple as that. This technology has been around for a very, very long time, Alka. Much more easier way to do it is, I don't know if you're aware of this tool called Tor, the Terminal Onion Router. With every time you actually hit the refresh on that, it actually constantly keeps changing the IP address. And that's the gateway to the dark web. Well, I think I'm digressing too much. The answer is yes, it is possible. How do you stop that? I'm coming to that. That's where I told you about this intelligent anomaly detection. You know, you should know that, you know, this is something suspicious which is happening. If it happens over, you know, a couple of times, then you actually use challenges. You use, who is this connection? I mean, should this be taken an additional approval by somebody? Should I have this as a red flag so that it can be investigated further? Should we record this particular session? Should we only allow read-only access to a few resources to start with before they can get full-fledged access into this entire system? All these are possible.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
I'm Ratnakar. This question is related to that phishing attack. In mm-hmm. most of the organizations, the mm-hmm. phishing attacks, the phisher will be he will be pretending himself as the top management, like a CIO or a CEO, and correct. Provide these details to their fellow employees in the correct. In the work in the employee group hierarchy. Mm-hmm. Then correct. The employees, without any hesitation, so they are disclosing the details, mm-hmm. Without knowing that that person who sent this message is an phishing. He is doing a phishing attack, or he is trying to steal the confidential details. How this can be avoided? And I think this is the common type nowadays. This type of attacks are very common. How
great
we
question.
Can yeah? How we can prevent
sure. from this? Kind of great question. Great question. Let me answer this two parts. The first part is nobody is 100% secure. There is nothing called as foolproof 100% security ever. With that being said, security itself is a combination of people, process, and technology. And more often than not, on these three pillars, people tend to be the weakest link, the weakest pillar in forms of technology, in form of this entire security gamut itself. So users will need to be trained. That is the long and short answer of these. So they will need to be trained to identify phishing emails. We have seen emails from our banks, right? We also get calls from genuine calls from our banks saying that don't share OTP, don't share your CVV and things like that, irrespective of whoever claims the other side, the caller is, or the mail, the sender of the mail is, or the chat person is, and all that, right? So that is the key. Today, mature organizations have trainings which are scheduled to identify phishing. Many organizations worldwide, companies which I currently support, we actually do something called as phishing awareness trainings, wherein we ourselves will pretend as the actor. We will send out a phishing email to all the users on a periodic basis. And once the users receive that, they will click the mail and then they'll say, this is a phishing email, you're not supposed to click on it. And it'll automatically get logged to us, and then we will assign them a particular training, and we will try and see, and we will educate them how to identify a genuine email versus a phishing email and all that. After a period of time, again, a new type of campaign, a phishing campaign will be done, and will be again pushed into the organization. Now, if the same user actually clicks on that is the first thing which we see. Whether has this training made any impact to this particular user, or is he a repeat offender? If he's a repeat offender, it means that my training is not working very well, or he has not made use of the training very well, because if it is working for everybody else and not this person, then it needs special counseling and all that. So we, you know, there is a process which we follow wherein we work with him or his manager to try and see why is it that this person is a repeat offender and all that to ensure phishing is this thing. So that is one way of doing it. Apart from that, there are email security and all that has evolved to actually identify phishing emails and all that. But even after that, today there are tools which where you receive a mail and then the person feels that this could be a phishing email, they could actually click on a button and then it goes to a dedicated cell which actually does a lot of analysis using machine learning, human intelligence, and there are also physical people in some cases who will identify, will work through that mail to identify whether that email is a true mail or is it a false positive, or whether it is a true phishing mail or a false positive. That also happens.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Any other question? Any other questions from the audience? Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Your session was very informative, and we understood that we must never trust and we should always verify. So thank you very much for accepting our invitation and for being here to enlighten all the participants. So we have research scholars as well today, students of VIT University, and also faculty members. It would be of very much use to them. Thank you very much, sir.
And thank you very much.
Participants, I am sending the link for the attendance. Please fill up this form. I have put it in the chat box. The next session will begin at 1:15 post lunch. Thank you very much, Shankar sir.
Thank you very much. Have a good day, everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye.